because you go, and you can still inhale from there. Okay, so that is at FRC, that's at the bottom. So, when we are at FRC for any of these places, including an RRR, what's our intrapleural pressure at RRR?
Zero.
Give me a no. Is a positive, negative what? Zero?
Zero.
How many say your intrapleural pressure is negative when you're at FRC?
Negative.
How many of you say it's positive? How many of you say it's zero? How many of you are gutless?
No.
There you go! Jane, you hit me!
That's me.
When you're at FRC, that rib cage is expanding outward. The tissue of your lung is expanding inward, and then they get to that equilibration point. They just kind of hold each other steady. That gas is negative. There's a negative intrapleural pressure. So at FRC, the average intrapleural pressure outside of that lung, between the chest wall, it might be like a minus five. And what is that doing? That's holding the lung open. The lung just wants to collapse, but that negative pressure is holding that lung. It's sustaining it outward just a little bit and holding it in place. So we have an intrapleural pressure of about minus five right there. What happens? Okay, it's not on here, but air's going in, so we know that's an inspiratory effort. What? How do you cause an inspiratory effort? What muscles contract?
Diaphragm.
Diaphragm.
External.
Does it go up or down?
Down.
It goes downward. What happens to your chest wall?
Expands
upward. Downward. So what happens to thoracic cavity volume?
Increases.
It increases. So what has to happen to intrapleural pressure?
Decrease.
It must decrease. It must decrease. So it started at a minus five, and maybe it went to a minus eight, so that intrapleural pressure is becoming negative. And what does that do? That pulls those alveoli outward. So alveolar volume is going to do what?
Increase.
So, what occurred to intrapleural pressure to allow for the movement from RR to SS? Which one of those looks good to you? It decreased, didn't it? It didn't start from zero. It started from some negative number, probably a minus five, and maybe it went to a minus eight.
No, it is.
Okay, so there's a concept there. So, what occurred to alveolar pressure to allow for the movement from RR to SS? So that's a tidal volume of gas coming into the lung. So air is flowing into the lung. And so what is alveolar pressure when you are at FRC? It doesn't matter if you're at TTRRQQOONNLL. When you are just relaxed.
Zero.
It's zero. Anytime there's no air moving in or out, you know it's zero. You know it's zero. So, well, that, you know, some of these are getting knocked out already. So, we make an inspiratory effort. We go from RR to SS. So, intrapleural pressure becomes negative. Alveolar walls expand outward, right? So alveolar pressure is going to do what? It started at zero. It's going to become negative. And what's going to happen then? Air is going to flow in, won't it? And when air flows in, what happens to its pressure? It goes back to zero. It goes back to zero. So it started at zero. It became negative. That caused the pressure gradient, allowing air to flow in. It went back to zero. So alveolar pressure at SS is zero, right? Instantaneously, right at that point. So what's alveolar pressure at MMPP at any of these places where, even instantaneously, airflow stops? You were going from inspiration to expiration, but right there in the middle it stops. What's that pressure?
Zero.
Anybody want to change their answer now? You can change your answer. Okay.
No, I will get better.
Change your answers.
Yeah, me too. Because like, you can...
So...
Yeah, like now it makes sense. So...
Yes, ask the question.
So for LL and NN...
So LL...
And NN, would so those would not be zeros if you're moving down the curve?
No, just right at that, just...
At that moment.
Well... Yeah, I made that artificial. If you stop, you're at zero. If you're passing through, it might not be.
Okay.
But you have to really word it.
Oh, I mean, because you're going from negative to positive.
Your thinking is absolutely correct.
Okay.
Your thinking is absolutely correct. Keep with that.
The reason is
hand your cards to the side.
From negative
to the middle here, and then we're going
so
to
at some point you're going to
we'll see about getting another
you know,
set of
going
cards.
Like,
are
yeah,
everybody okay with
like,
concepts?
So when I looked at this, MMM is essentially a technically a positive. It's going from zero to positive.
Okay.
Yeah. So you're going from the top of the curve, which is zero.
Next slide.
Negative. And then, like, positive. You know, like, you reach zero and then you keep going.
But, you know, it seems like a mean thing to do, but, you know, when you put somebody on the spot, you know, you're thinking a little bit better than
makes
you
sense.
Talk back and forth.
No,
I'm far more interested that you walk out of this room having to go, okay, now this fits, rather than knowing maybe before something didn't fit. So hopefully you understand maybe a little more clearly how those questions can come up. So we're down here to control respiration. Luckily, just like heart rate, just like 100, 200, 300, maybe 1,000 different, well, thousands of different things in the body, we don't have to think about it. It's automatic. Can we think about it and change how fast we breathe in and breathe out? Yeah, we can. But as you're sitting here, you're not thinking, oh, I better take a breath now. It's, think about your heart rate. Your SA node has this spontaneous depolarization that leads to action potentials that will set a rhythm in a normal heart. Well, you have, just like in the SA node, it can be a pacemaker, you have pacemaker activity in your brainstem. And you know for your heart rate, yeah, you can modulate your heart rate. Sympathetics can speed up that depolarization rate, parasympathetics can slow it down, so you can change heart rate. Well, even though we have respiratory pacemaker activity, we have many inputs that will tell the body, you know what, we're under increased metabolic demand right now, breathe faster, breathe more deeply, increase ventilation, increase alveolar ventilation, or I'm just sitting in class, not doing much, I don't have a whole lot of energy metabolism going on. I don't need to ventilate as much. And your breathing slows down. So that's what we're going to look at here. This looks kind of scary, but it really, really isn't. We're going to just kind of build this up one area at a time and talk about, right here is your pacemaker. And it's here. So here we're in the brainstem right here. We're in the brainstem. So here's the medulla. Here's the pons where these centers are, and there's many more respiratory centers than these, but this is the simplest way. A graduate student I worked with years and years ago, Betty Dowdy, she drew this out this way, and she made something very simple out of something that's inherently very complex. And it's like, oh, wow, if you just go through this one step at a time, it's not nearly as frightening. And so let's just do that. Let's just do that. So you have a pacemaker in your medulla that it has a spontaneous depolarization rate just like the SA node. It'll depolarize, and when it depolarizes, it activates this thing called the dorsal respiratory group, and when it fires, guess what? It causes for the phrenic nerve to fire. So when the dorsal respiratory center is activated, it causes your phrenic nerve to fire. And what does your phrenic nerve innervate? Your diaphragm. Absolutely. So this pacemaker depolarizes, it activates the dorsal respiratory group, activates the phrenic nerve, you get skeletal muscle contraction of your diaphragm. Your diaphragm's kind of interesting. It's almost a hybrid muscle. But the contraction characteristics are just like skeletal muscle contraction, which it really classically is. So it's skeletal muscle. It needs to be told what to do and when to do it. It does not contract on its own. What tells it to contract? The phrenic nerve activates it. So there's that neuromuscular activation. So you're just sitting here and you have your pacemakers firing and you are ventilating at a certain rate. Well, you have a number of things that are providing information to the dorsal respiratory group and the pacemaker. These are really linked together. So if information's coming in here, it's also going to the pacemaker, okay? So there's information coming in that can really impact that pacemaker. You can think of these as, you know, they're linked together. What effects one's gonna affect the other? Now, what if you go, well, you know, I'm going to take a much deeper inspiratory effort. Well, your dorsal respiratory group kind of asks your ventral respiratory group, hey guys, how about a little bit of help? And it'll activate the accessory muscles of inspiration, your sternocleidomastoideus, your scalenus muscles, your pec minor, and also cause increased contraction of your external intercostals. So yeah, there's another area. But this ventral respiratory center is also the center that is activated when you want to do a forced expiration. So anytime you want to go below that functional residual capacity, you have to contract your abdominal musculature and your internal intercostals. That requires activation of that center too. And there's some pretty specific brainstem injuries where you can injure one area of these respiratory centers, but the other ones are intact, and it causes some, well, there's certain patterns of respiration you're going to learn about. And as Betty taught me, is boy, if you just understand some of these, and then you see some of these clinical manifestations, you kind of go, aha. Now, what can affect this dorsal respiratory center and pacemaker activity? We have chemoreceptors throughout the body that are constantly monitoring things such as oxygen, pH, CO2. They're monitoring factors that give information on your level of metabolism. Are you in a high metabolic activity state? Are you in a low metabolic activity state? More metabolism, you need more energy. To make that energy, you need oxygen to make the ATP. Okay? So you have chemoreceptors throughout the body. We're just going to talk about two basic types of chemoreceptors. And for example, the arterial or peripheral chemoreceptors. If your arterial chemoreceptors or peripheral chemoreceptors, person's talking about the same thing. You have them in various places throughout the body, but they are at very high concentration in your carotid bodies and your aortic bodies. Now, the carotid body is not the same as the carotid sinus. The carotid sinus is that area that's constantly measuring blood pressure. And, you know, we saw how that can change sympathetic and parasympathetic discharge. But right next to it, it's about the size of half of a pea. There's a carotid body that's just right near the carotid sinus. And in the aorta, you also have these small little pieces of tissue that turns out they're just loaded with certain sensory receptors. And when these bodies are activated, what do? They cause an increase in ventilation. So what activates these carotid and aortic bodies? So here's, your book shows that your aortic bodies are there, your carotid bodies are found. Here's your carotid sinus. Your carotid body's just right close to there. So there are these afferent neurons. And when these bodies are activated, neural discharge goes up this afferent neuron to where? Your brain stem. And that's going to affect pacemaker activity. Speed it up or slow it down. So, in your carotid and aortic bodies, you have these receptors that are constantly sensing arterial oxygen, arterial CO2, and arterial pH. And what causes those sensors to activate? If you have low arterial oxygen, that activates that sensor, that activates the afferent neuron, that activates the dorsal respiratory group, and what happens? You breathe faster. That increases pacemaker activity. So, if there's a low amount of partial pressure of arterial oxygen, that, you go, whoa, we need to have more oxygen. Those chemoreceptors are activated, and that stimulates ventilation to help relieve that problem. What if arterial CO2 is elevated? There are sensors in those two areas that will also activate. So they can activate if there's low oxygen, they can activate if there's high CO2. And they can also activate if there's low pH. Now, all of these will happen to some degree when you have increased metabolic activity. Oxygen can go down just a smidge. CO2 can go up just a smidge. pH can go down a little bit. All of that input activates those different sensory receptors, activating the afferent neuron, going up to the brainstem, telling that dorsal respiratory group and that pacemaker, fire more rapidly, breathe a little more quickly, alleviate these conditions. Now, what that triple asterisk means is for me to remind you, this goes in the other direction too. If arterial oxygen is elevated, that can decrease the activation of these receptors. If your CO2 is low, it'll actually decrease. If your pH is high, it'll actually decrease. You'll see some slides coming up. We're far more, we're much more sensitive to CO2 and pH changes than oxygen changes. You'll see that. So here's a way that oxygen, CO2, and pH in the bloodstream are constantly being monitored, and that can lead to changes in ventilation rate. Yes?
So are all three of those different minor, like different lanes of the highway?
Yeah. Yes, that's exact. There are different sensory receptors for each of them. It's different fibers within the same nerve, but they all terminate in the same place, in that pacemaker. So you can have one of these firing and the other two aren't doing anything, so there's a little bit of an input. If you have all three of them firing simultaneously, let's say you go out and you run 400 meters very, very hard, all three of those are going to be activated, and you're going to get a much greater ventilatory response. So while they are independent of one another, they are self-supporting of one another, and you can artificially set somebody up with high CO2 but normal oxygen, well, they're just going to ventilate away. So they don't all have to be present at the same time, just one or the other. Yes?
Most of the time, are they in the body, like naturally?
Well, are they, what do
like,
you mean?
Do they all have, like, when you have low oxygen, don't you normally have high CO2 then?
Very commonly. Very,
okay, so what,
very, very commonly.
What circumstances would that not be true?
There are a number of respiratory circumstances where you can get slight variations of that. It's not just, but when you're just thinking about metabolic activity,
mm-hmm.
they all work just the way you're thinking. Oxygen would be going down, CO2 would be going up, pH would be going down. So when you're thinking about increased metabolic activity, it's just exactly what you would think. But do think of it the other way. If CO2 goes down, oxygen goes up, pH goes up, ventilation would go down, okay? Now this provides breath-to-breath alterations in ventilation. You know that almost all of us have done this. You take a brown paper bag and you breathe in it. What you're doing is, you know, you're inhaling your expired gases. So you're rebreathing some of your CO2. And you know, if it's just a little lunch bag, about how many breaths does it take before you start taking a deeper breath? Only 3 or 4. Unless you consciously try to fight it. That's how quickly and how small the changes of CO2 can stimulate ventilation. And way back when with the med students, we used to take tanks of CO2, and it's just amazing how small amounts of CO2 will very rapidly change ventilation. And then you get some kid in front of a class of 160 and you give them a little CO2 and give them a little bit more gas. Jeez, I don't want to kill them. Take the mask off. You're a deep water diver, aren't you? Yep. Okay. But they just learn how to control things and be, it's okay. I don't feel the world closing in. Just keep breathing normally. So, but his body was trying to tell him to ventilate, but he was just going, mellow out. Well, that just made a mess of in front of 160 people. Anybody normal in here? Yeah, I don't deep water dive. They got down and they're hyperventilating. Okay, so we also have central chemoreceptors. These are up here in our medulla. These are up in the medulla. They're actually on the brain side of the blood-brain barrier. They're not exposed to blood. They're exposed to cerebral spinal fluid. Okay? They're exposed to cerebral spinal fluid, and they are activated by high cerebral spinal fluid, CO2, and low cerebral spinal fluid, pH. You notice oxygen's not there. They're totally insensitive to oxygen. They don't have an oxygen sensor. They don't have an oxygen sensor. Now, they can be activated by changes in arterial CO2, but it takes about 2 minutes for arterial CO2 to adequately get across that blood-brain barrier to make a significant difference. So they are sensitive to arterial CO2, but the CO2 needs to go across the blood-brain barrier in sufficient quantity to activate these chemoreceptors that are on the other side of the blood-brain barrier. So activation of these chemoreceptors causes an increase in ventilation. Inactivation of these cause a decrease in ventilation. And it's thought, and well, it's pretty much understood that your central chemoreceptors are really what provide most of your steady state respiratory control. So your peripheral, your breath-to-breath adjustments, this is your baseline. So here in Lincoln, you have certain ventilation. I was terrible. I don't remember. I can't think of any of you right now. When you go back home, if you live at elevation, but just go into Laramie, Wyoming, or something like that. You go a couple thousand feet higher, your ventilation rate will be just a little bit faster, but you won't really notice it. But your steady state ventilation rate is more controlled by the central chemoreceptors than the arterial. So these chemoreceptors, they are sending afferent neural traffic to this area, and it's adjusting both the central and the peripheral, the ventilation rate. Is that Everybody kind of okay with that? So we've got a pacemaker here, but we can increase its rate of activity or decrease its rate of activity, and that's going to increase or decrease the phrenic nerve activity to the diaphragm. Okay. Now we have, and we'll go through this again. I want you to, here is little bits of increase in CO2. You see big differences in ventilation. We're going to see it's completely different for oxygen, and we're going to go through these. I'm not sure why I didn't pull that slide out. So here we have CO2, and most of our ventilatory drive in humans is due to CO2. We always think, well, we breathe because we need oxygen, and that is true. But we're far, far more sensitive to small changes in CO2. And we're going to see there's good reasons for that. CO2, you can think of arterial CO2 as an acid producer. Small amounts of CO2 can cause pretty dramatic shifts in your extracellular pH. So we're really set up to control CO2. So you know from those slide presentations that what's your arterial CO2? It's about 40 torr. So if you draw, and I think I drew this, so it's 40. And your alveolar ventilation rate, it might be about 4 liters. But look, if your arterial CO2 goes up just a little bit, you have a pretty good increase in ventilation rate. There is this almost linear relationship between arterial CO2 and alveolar ventilation. As CO2 goes up, ventilation goes up. As CO2 goes down, ventilation goes down. You see that is a linear steep relationship. And this is why you're just breathing in a bag. Very quickly, in less than 30 seconds, between 30 and 40 seconds, small amounts of accumulation of CO2 will cause you to take deeper and deeper breaths. It's very quick, it's very responsive. You're extremely sensitive to this. Okay, so there's a lot of things that, here's the normal line right here, this white line, that's the normal line. There is a lot of things that will change our sensitivity to CO2. Everything that's to the right and downward decreases our sensitivity to CO2. Everything that's to the left increases our sensitivity to CO2. So just draw a vertical line up from, say, 45 straight up. And what this is telling you, when you are in deep sleep, you're slightly less sensitive to the stimulating effects of CO2. Now, people with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease or chronic bronchitis or emphysema, and this takes a long time. Over a long period of time, as those people who have ventilation difficulties or maybe they have diffusion capacity problems, they can accumulate more and more CO2 slowly over time. And there is a adaptation, remember sensory receptor adaptation. And their CO2 sensory systems become less and less sensitive to CO2. So they have less, what this is showing is less ventilatory drive to CO2. Now, with different degrees of impairment, that line looks different. It started this way, but with disease progression over years and years and years, it'll start doing this. Now, narcotics, especially opioid drugs, more people are dying today due to prescription drugs than illegal. Well, this is changing because now heroin's making a big comeback, but opioid drugs, they cause a tremendous decrease in our sensitivity to CO2. So, what is the cause of death for most opioid induced deaths? It's loss of ventilatory drive. Their bodies forget to breathe. They've lost their sensitivity to CO2 and asphyxiate essentially because they've lost their respiratory drive to CO2. Now, when you will be working with patients with deep plain surgical anesthesia, guess what? They need to be mechanically ventilated because deep plain anesthesia with a number of different types of anesthetics, one of the consequences of them is they really decrease ventilatory drive to CO2, so you need to mechanically ventilate for them. Now, the only thing I'm showing on the left side is metabolic acidosis. If you go out and you run really, really hard and generate a lot of acid because of those muscle contractions, that actually you will have an increased ventilation, a massive increase in ventilation due to an increase in your sensitivity to CO2. So most of our ventilatory drive is due to CO2, changes in CO2, but there's a lot of things that will manipulate it. And this is, boy, this is really old. I should have updated this. There was a, boy, this goes back 8 years ago, an actor, Heath Ledger. He died due to overdose. But in his case, it was tragic, obviously, but it was interesting. He had small amounts of 6 drugs in his body, and as I recall, 5 of them were respiratory suppressants, and no one of them was at a level that should have been even close to fatal. It was because those 5 were in the system at the same time that they had an additive effect. And here's Michael Jackson, and you know, here he was given a surgical anesthetic to go to sleep, supposedly a small amount, and to get him to sleep. And well, there's a narrow window between sedation, which this doctor was trying to do, and full general anesthesia, with possible loss of the patient's ability to breathe and maintain their airway. Respiratory suppression, that was the problem. And so he did time. I threw this in a couple of years ago, well, 3 years ago now, just to scare straight the dental students, because here's a young man who went in for so many different dental offices offer sedation. And depending on the person who goes in and how they react to sedation, here's a young man who just went in to get his wisdom teeth removed. And he died due to respiratory suppression. And the meeting I was at Chicago, you know, there's a big, big push to more carefully regulate at state levels the use of sedatives in all of the healthcare professions, because some people in different states have different requirements on what's required to be licensed to use certain sedatives. And some of those, some states, it's basically a continuing education course at a hotel over a weekend. And that, there's a lot of professions going, no, we want far more strict regulation of that. And I found out that in the last 5 years in Texas, there have been 4 infants that have, not infants, 4 children that have died due to this type of thing, where there was inadequate emergency support for simple sedation in different types of offices. So this is something you're going to hear a whole lot more about, but bottom line is different types of sedatives will, and also getting into the opioids, what do they do? They decrease, one of the things they do is they decrease your sensitivity to CO2 and your ventilatory drive goes down, and that can lead to a lot of problems very, very quickly. pH, the line looks very much like CO2. Very small changes in pH can lead to very, look at the steepness of that line. Small changes in pH lead to large changes in ventilation. pH goes down, ventilation goes up. Quite different for oxygen. This is why I say most of our ventilatory drive is due to CO2. It's also very, very closely associated with pH, but look at oxygen. What's your arterial oxygen as you sit here right now? Your arterial oxygen is probably about 100. But look how low it has to go before you have a tremendous increase in ventilation. So most of our ventilatory drive is due to changes in CO2 and also pH. Oxygen? Well, yes, if we become very hypoxic, if we have hypoxemia, low blood oxygen, if we get very, very low, below 60, in that range of 50, then we'll have a very strong stimulation of ventilation. But look at how low that has to go compared to CO2. And there's other, this line changes according to CO2, and I just gave you the standard line, but there's other things that can move that line. Just like you saw, different things can move the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. But it's just good to see how most of our ventilatory drive is not due to oxygen. It's not due to oxygen. Okay, so chemoreceptors are feeding information into the dorsal respiratory group, causing us to breathe faster, breathe slowly, more slowly according to what's necessary. Well, neural reflexes also play a very important role in providing information to this dorsal respiratory group to speed up or slow down ventilation. Now, there's many of these, and I'm just gonna talk generally about some of these. Muscle joint reflexes. Now, there is a text handout that you didn't get. And I need to put on Moodle or email you guys the text handout that has most of this written out. It's one of the problems with me this morning, realizing that, oh, I have some stuff at the other office. There's something else I wanted to print out and give you. But, for example, muscle joint reflexes. You can have somebody anesthetized. So, you know, they're just kind of wiped out. And you can start moving their joints passively. They're not doing it. You're moving their joints passively, and the area of their brain for the diaphragm lights up. So just by moving joints, just by moving your joints, you actually stimulate inflation responses. And, you know, so the extreme end of that is you take somebody who's anesthetized and you move a joint, and yes, you're having to mechanically ventilate, but you can see it actually increase in ventilatory drive. Even though they're not contracting muscles, you're just moving joints. So that's kind of nice that that's built into us. Pain, this is something that it's different between some types of pain and other types of pain. Especially surface A delta pain, sharp pains, what do? They cause us to hyperventilate. But if you have deep visceral pain, especially in the abdominal cavity, it decreases ventilation rate. So you might see patients that are just like, and they are barely ventilating. Part of that's a guarding response. They're just trying to get out of pain, and so they're not doing movements to exacerbate the pain, but it's thought that in our ancestors, if you had an internal injury, you didn't want much movement going on, so you decrease ventilation. Well, that decreased the movement to hopefully not make the bleeding any worse. Lung inflation and deflation responses. And yeah, this, you'll have something, I think I have a written handout. But if the lung suddenly inflates, if something either pushes gas into the lung very rapidly, or let's say it's not really even lung inflation, it's a pressure generation. If pressure in your airways suddenly increases and your airways are stretched outward, either by air rushing in, or the other thing, and many of you have had this happen, you're about to take a hit, you brace yourself, what have you just done? You've closed off your glottis, you're in a full Valsalva maneuver. You get hit in the chest, what does that do? Air from your lung goes into your airways, it hits the brick wall here, your airways stretch open, because that air is coming up, it hits that closed glottis, and you stretch your airways. That's an inflation reflex. That happens when you get the wind knocked out of you. How many of you, when you were a kid, got the wind knocked out of you? Yeah, usually about half. What was your first response? Oh, I'm gonna die, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Why? You couldn't breathe. You stopped breathing. That's what happens with a lung inflation reflex. You get apnea, a cessation of breathing. So when you're a little kid, and my neighborhood where I was growing up, all the guys were 4 to 6 years older than me, so of course I couldn't play with them unless, well, we're gonna play football, and Larry, you get to be the football. I literally was the football. Many times when I was like 6, 7 years old, that they would be carrying me and boom, 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 boom. And first time I got the wind knocked out of me, it was like, well, you know, it was a good ride. I'm 8 years old, I've seen a lot. But you know, like you, I thought I'm gonna die because I can't take a breath. Well, that's what happens with the lung inflation reflex. So either air rushing into the airways unexpectedly causing that tracheobronchial tree to stretch out, or air being driven out of the lung into the airways while you're doing a Valsalva maneuver, while you're tensing, and that air hits that closed glottis and you have this reflex stretching of the airways because of their pressurization. Now, a lung deflation reflex is just opposite. If you suddenly have air taken out of the lung, you go into this period of hypertonia.
So the lung inflation reflex stops your breathing, and then the deflation one, it increases it?
Yes. And these are reflexes. They happen just like that. So, you know, this will make a lot of you uncomfortable to hear about this, but when I was at LSU, the emergency medicine folks, they'd have dog surgical labs when they would run codes and so forth, and would have the first year medical students help with them. And I'd have to help with these, and with the D1 students, when we'd say, okay, we're gonna test this, and it's one thing, well, let's test an inflation reflex, and there's a endotracheal tube come out, so you know, a student waits so the dog's not breathing, they blow into it, and there's this period of apnea, and you go, well, you know, this is exactly what's going to happen in humans. It's even a little bit more acute. And then who's going to do the deflation reflex? And so I go, oh, geez, I don't want to suck the breath out of a dog. And dog's panting like this, and of course they're in deep plain anesthesia, and they're never to wake up again. And you know, I'm standing there with a bulb going, wow, I would have just used this to pull a little air out. But you know, you're the clinician. That's good. And they okay, so there's these neural reflexes and there's chemoreceptor reflexes. These, in real time, are regulating your ventilation rate, that basal pacemaker activity rate. There's other things that the information is dorsal respiratory group. The apneustic center, and this is your inspiratory cutoff switch, and it leads to a, you get to the top, and then you want those inspiratory muscles to cut off in a fine, controlled fashion. And Dana, did you ever have patients that had said a break? And that's, it's different from agonal breathing, but when there's a brainstem problem with that area, this, yeah, you think, oh yeah, you want inspiration. Okay, that is your neural traffic going out and you want it to stop. And once it stops, then expiration is passive. And you don't think about it, but you want all these fibers going down the phrenic nerve to, you know, you want things to shut off in a coordinated fashion. And it turns out there is a small area in here that, that helps that coordinated shut off, inspiratory cut off switch. And then there's a pneumotaxic center. Now we're getting up, we're in the pons up here. Down here, we're in the medulla. This is up in the pons, so we're still in the brainstem. Pneumotactic center, it really coordinates your inspiratory and your expiratory efforts, so you get this, or this quiet tidal breathing you're doing. It's just wonderfully coordinated in a typical healthy person. And the pneumotactic center helps with that coordination between inspiration and expiration to keep everything kind of equal. So I'm sure someplace along the line you're going to learn about brainstem injuries at different levels and different types of respiratory impairment. I've seen a couple of examples of this, unfortunately, and it's pretty nasty. Yep, cortical influences. You can certainly, there is an area in your motor cortex that is dedicated to the diaphragm. So when the dorsal respiratory group fires, it actually activates a certain area of in your motor cortex, and that's what sends the neural impulses down the phrenic nerve. So since you have an area in the motor cortex that's controlling your diaphragm, obviously, you can voluntarily breathe faster and breathe slower. So all these together help control your ventilation rate. And it does it remarkably well in a healthy person. But all sorts of things can happen. Either these centers or what's going on with chronic bronchitis. How does that affect this? You know, what's going on with some of the other problems? Now, I did want to take a few minutes and talk about acid-base homeostasis. And most of, there will be an independent study for acid-base, but really what I want you to know is there's two things that regulate pH in your body. It's in your extracellular fluid, excuse me. It's the amount of CO2 and the amount of bicarbonate. So the CO2 bicarbonate buffering system is by far the most important buffering system in your body. Your respiratory system regulates CO2. Your renal system regulates bicarbonate. Is the CO2 bicarbonate buffering system, it's a weak buffer, but it works really, really well because we have the lungs regulating the CO2, we have the kidneys regulating the bicarb. And you need to keep things in balance. Now, whenever there's an accumulation of CO2, this equation gets driven to the right. And if you're like me when I was first learning this, I go, well, that's not going to change the pH, you know, because, okay, yeah, you're developing a proton, that'd be acid, but you're making a base. Bicarbonate's a base, so you're making one acid, you're making one proton. Everything's okay. Well, actually, to have a pH of 7.4, you need to have 20 bicarbs for every one proton. 20 bicarbs for every one proton. So, let's say you put a 20 there and a 1 there. And let's say you put an extra CO2 in the system and an extra water in the system. You always have water, it's never a limiting factor for these things. So if this drives once to the right, what do we now have? 21 bicarbs and 2 protons. Guess what? You need to have a ratio of 20 to 1 to have a pH of 7.4. If you now have 21 to 2, what's that ratio? 10.5 to 1. That's a huge change in ratio. And what does that do? That makes you acidotic. You need 20 to 1. So anytime you produce 1 to 1, you are becoming acidotic. You're becoming acidotic. So I tell people, think of CO2 in the bloodstream as a potential acid producer. If this equation goes to the right, you're becoming acidotic. Because going to the right, you're going to make one proton and one bicarb, and that isn't a 20 to 1 ratio. That's a 1 to 1 ratio. So to maintain a pH of 7.4, you need a 20 to 1 ratio of bicarbs to protons. And so, and some people will just say CO2, because one CO2 is going to give you a proton. A normal pH in your bloodstream is 7.4. Anything lower than 7.35 is an acidosis. Anything greater than 7.45 is an alkalosis. Now, you already know that your normal arterial CO2 is 40 torr. But anytime arterial CO2 is above 45, that's going to be driving that equation to the right. That can lead to an acidosis. Anytime it is below 35, that in and of itself can lead to an alkalosis. And remember, and there was one, it's bottom one of your slides. Arterial CO2 is determined by partial pressure of alveolar CO2, and alveolar CO2 is determined by ventilation. So your ventilation rate is very much going to affect your CO2. Your ventilation rate is going to affect your pH. So CO2, pH is impacted by CO2. CO2 is impacted by alveolar CO2. Alveolar CO2 is determined by alveolar ventilation. So you change alveolar ventilation, guess what? You change your pH. They're all linked together. They're all linked together. So, this is high alveolar ventilation decreases. So, if we increase alveolar ventilation rate, what happens to the amount of CO2 in our alveoli? It goes down. It goes down a lot. And remember, what's in our arteries equilibrates to what's in our alveoli in a normal, healthy person. So if you increase alveolar ventilation rate, high alveolar ventilation decreases P big A CO2. It's also going to decrease P little a arterial CO2. What's it going to do? It will increase pH. If you decrease alveolar CO2, that's going to decrease arterial CO2. So changing your ventilation rate is going to change the amount of CO2 in your alveoli and in your bloodstream. So this is something to know. If you're just hyperventilating for no reason, if you're hyperventilating, you are ventilating faster than your current metabolic needs. Ultimately, what's going to happen is you're going to decrease arterial CO2, and that's going to increase pH. So think about it. If you're blowing off CO2 faster than your body's producing it, this equation's going to move to the left. And that equation moves to the left, you become alkalotic. When it moves to the right, you become acidotic. If you hypoventilate, if you're not ventilating sufficiently to get rid of the CO2 that your body is producing every minute, CO2 is going to accumulate in your arterial CO2 is going to accumulate. What's that going to do? That's going to cause that equation to go to the right. You're going to become acidotic. So think of arterial CO2 as a potential acid producer. If it accumulates, you become acidotic. If you lose it, you become alkalotic. So, traumatic injury or to the brainstem, I'm not sure if I mentioned you. Yeah, I did mention you guys, I think. Right before I gave a ventilatory control lecture, I get a call from a friend down in New Orleans saying that one of the professors I cared so much about got hit in the back of the head with a bus rear view mirror and it had brainstem injury and he lost ventilatory drive. So, traumatic injury to the brainstem, anesthetics, narcotics, all of those may lead to respiratory suppression. So a person is not ventilating sufficiently to get rid of CO2. So if you hypoventilate, that will lead to what's called a respiratory acidosis. The respiratory acidosis is an acidosis that's being caused by a defect or dysfunction of the respiratory system. So, if for whatever reason you are hypoventilating and CO2 is accumulating, that's due to a respiratory problem, and that would be a respiratory acidosis. Now, you will have patients, and some of you have done this, become very nervous, anxious about something, and you start breathing a little more deeply, a little more quickly. This is your body's way of preparing for action. In our ancestors, that hyperventilation made them a little bit alkalotic. Why? Well, maybe there was a herd of wildebeest about to run over them. So they're now going to run away. And when you're exercising, you're producing acid. If you start from an alkalotic point first, you can increase, for at least a few seconds, high-level physical activity. So your body's natural response when you feel threatened, hyperventilation. It's doing two things. It's increasing the amount of oxygen in your system. It's decreasing the amount of CO2. And as a consequence of that, it's increasing your pH. So if you're going to do some great physical acid-producing activity, you're starting from a high pH. It'll take longer to get to a low pH. So anxiety, going to high altitude, and certain drugs that directly activate respiratory centers can lead to hyperventilation. So if an alkalosis is due to hyperventilation, it's a respiratory alkalosis. So you're going to see that, well, it's coming up here. There are other ways of getting acidoses and alkalosis. And there's this term metabolic. Metabolic means non-respiratory. Anything that's not respiratory. So you can affect pH by breathing too fast or breathing too slow. If you breathe fast and it causes a elevation of pH, that's a respiratory alkalosis. If you breathe too slow, CO2 accumulates. Well, that's due to the respiratory system, so that's a respiratory acidosis. So it's easy to just look at pH, but this tells you the cause. Now, anything other than a change in ventilation causing a pH derangement is automatically called metabolic. Metabolic means non-respiratory. And your body uses changes in ventilation to compensate for pH derangement. So yes, you can have some type of deficiency in number 6 or number 7 of the respiratory system, and that can lead to a pH problem, but your respiratory system bails out the rest of the body. 2, a metabolic acidosis. Say you go out and you exercise really, really hard, you're producing lactate, you're generating what's called a metabolic acidosis, the pH of the blood is going down. Well, guess what? Just what we learned in ventilatory control, if your pH goes down, that activates those peripheral chemoreceptors. What does it cause you to do? To ventilate faster. So, metabolic acidosis can be compensated by a hyperventilation maneuver. And the way I tell students to remember this, and it's very, very simple, metabolic acidosis can be compensated by something that would normally, by itself, cause just the opposite, respiratory alkalosis. Hyperventilation and respiratory alkalosis go together. A lot of other ways of getting a metabolic acidosis. There's some people that, oh man, they're acid junkies. They might drink 4 liters of Diet Mountain Dew a day. They're taking in massive amounts of acid. Guess what? Those people will actually have an increase in ventilation to help keep their pH in that normal range. Metabolic alkalosis. Oh, and there's other, for example, a lot of ways to get metabolic acidosis. Bad diarrhea. When somebody has bad diarrhea, they lose a lot of bicarbonate. So, person can be hyperventilating and not even knowing that. So the respiratory system can lead to pH derangement, but the respiratory system can compensate for some out of the pulmonary system pH derangement. Metabolic alkalosis, some people just take a whole lot of Tums or calcium carbonate. That can lead to a metabolic alkalosis. They're actually hypoventilating. They're breathing slower to build up CO2 to counteract that elevation of pH. That's somebody who's vomiting a lot. If you're vomiting a lot, you're losing a lot of protons. That can lead to a metabolic alkalosis. Yes?
I just remember that I was speaking about when I lived in South America, and they had altitude sickness.
Yes.
That was through the back to the subject when I was in Cusco, which is where I was in Hoy.
Some people just can't help it.
The popular thing that locals do, they don't chew the coca leaves.
So I gave you these teeter-totters that are just kind of helped you to visualize. So your respiratory system controls CO2, your renal system controls bicarbonate, and normally you need 20 bicarbs to one CO2 for everything to be in balance. So I want you to see if you can understand. You can get an acidosis one of two ways. You can have either too much of that respiratory acid, CO2, respiratory acid producer, CO2. You can just as easily get an acidosis if your CO2 is normal, but your bicarb is too low. Does that just kind of make sense? Once I started using these teeter-totters, everybody went, yay, oh yeah, that makes sense. And an alkalosis, that can be generated in one of two ways. You can either have too little of this respiratory acid producer, CO2, and that equation is going to the left, or you can have too much of the metabolic base, bicarbonate. And the great thing about your respiratory system in a normal, healthy person, it wants to make things right. It's there for you. So let's say you have a respiratory acidosis. Well, what your body will do by hyperventilating, get rid of some of that respiratory acid producer, some of that CO2, and that balances out. And if you happen to have a respiratory, well, this gets into how the kidneys do it, but here we have too much CO2. Well, guess what? The kidneys, they're smart little guys. They do many things. Well, they make urine. Well, yeah, and about 20 other things for you. One thing they'll do is they'll take that excess CO2 and they will make it into bicarb, good for them. And that helps balance the system. So this is, up here is respiratory compensation for a metabolic problem. Down here is metabolic compensation for a respiratory problem. And then I ask these questions, how is a metabolic alkalosis compensated? Well, by something that would normally cause just the opposite, a respiratory acidosis. Okay, respiratory acidosis, that's hypoventilation. So a metabolic alkalosis, well, I think hypoventilation might be in order. How's a respiratory alkalosis? Oh, somebody's hyperventilating. How's that compensated? Well, over time and by something that would normally cause a metabolic acidosis, and that's getting rid of bicarb, and your kidneys are very good at getting rid of bicarb if it needs to. So, I gave you some of these things to look at. There's an order that you always, always, always follow when you try to differentiate acid-base disorders. Always follow this order. You look at pH first. You ask yourself, is it an acidosis or an alkalosis, or is it normal? And what's normal? 7.4. What's acidosis? Below 7.35. Alkalosis above 7.45. Then you look at CO2, and then you ask yourself the question, can this derangement be due to the respiratory system? Is this disorder consistent with the respiratory disorder? If so, then it's respiratory disorder. If the CO2, arterial CO2, which is respiratory, cannot be causing the problem, it automatically is non-respiratory, meaning metabolic. And then is compensation occurring? So you always go in that order, and you never vary from that order, and you don't start looking at oxygen and other things first. Other things will give some added information. So I want you to take a look at this, at some of these. So is that an acidosis or an alkalosis? That's an acidosis. Okay, an acidosis, if you had a respiratory acidosis, that would mean you'd have a CO2 of 45 or over. Does he have a CO2 of 45 or over? No. So that means it's not due to respiratory. It must be metabolic. And so you just kind of step through these things. So this is a metabolic acidosis, and don't worry about the compensation just yet. But take a look at these and go through that order and see if they make sense to you. Okay? So, is anybody in town tomorrow? Anybody want to meet at 7:30, or does anybody take off on vacation? So, anybody around, anybody want to meet? Okay, we won't. So, happy Thanksgiving. Be safe. Say hi to your families.
Hey guys, whoever is bringing food tonight, if it's warm, supposed to be warm food, try to bring it as warm as possible, because there's limited, I mean, we only have